Welcome, everybody. Today's video is called Going Up, taken from Exodus chapter 24. God commands Moses and says, go up to meet God, which is strange because God is speaking to him. So God is already there speaking to him. So why would God say, go up to meet God? And of course, we have the whole aspect of Trinity and Father and Son. But putting that aside, it's like what God is saying, that no matter where you are with God, don't never be content. Amen. Go up to other levels. Like the Apostle John said in Revelations, Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12, for I and you are man within the body, out of the body, I cannot tell, you ascended to the third heaven. Amen. Not the first heaven, the second heaven, the third heaven. Amen. And showing you that God, his desire always is that we know him better. That's what we see with Moses. God said to Moses, Exodus 24, verse 1, go up to meet God. God's desire for you is that you should grow. Amen. Like many people, amen, desire to live long lives, to 100, 110, 90, whatever. But these, amen, is only given to us, praise be to God, with an objective that we know God better. Like God said to Abraham when he was 100. Amen. And it came to pass, God said, walk thou before me and be thou perfect. Meaning that I've allowed you to live now to 100. It's your 100th birthday. And we have a custom in England here that when you reach 100, you get a letter from the Queen congratulating you. Amen. But not so in the scripture. Abraham didn't get a letter from the Queen. He got a message from God that, amen, now he's 100, walk before me, be thou perfect. Meaning, rise, raise your standard. Amen, go up to a better level, do better. In fact, not just do better, but perfect. Amen, so if we desire to see many days and to live longer, if you want God to give that to you, let him know that your desire is to go up. Your desire is to walk before him and be thou perfect. Even if you're not perfect, but that's your desire. Like David said, one thing have I desired. Not 10 things, and that is to, amen, to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What does that mean? Meaning to try to live perfect, praise be to God, by God's grace. Meaning never coming out of God's house. Even if your body is the temple of God, it means never coming out of the frame of mind that this temple belongs to God. Amen. And so many of us forget that when we turn aside and begin to eat too much fatty foods. Amen. Some of us smoke, Christians, some maybe drink more than you should. Praise be to God. Amen. And begin to, not like Apostle Paul said, he presents his body as a living sacrifice, meaning he's always aware that the temple that he has is a temple of the living God. And that attitude, amen, like Apostle Paul said, man ought always to pray and not to faint, for the flesh is weak and the spirit is willing. So once you have that mind that you always want to pray, then be assured you begin to go up. Oh, brothers and sisters, what does the Ecclesiastes say? What is the whole duty of man but to fear God and to keep his commandments? Now, let's look at these two things in relationship to rising up. If that's the whole duty of man, it means the two things that we've got to concentrate on, amen, praise God, is fearing God, and number two, obeying him, keeping his commandments. Two things that are not easy to do. They're really not easy to do, and except we understand how to do them. The scripture teaches us how to fear God. In Joshua chapter 1, and you'll find it also in Deuteronomy chapter 17, when God is talking about the leader, the king, he's saying that they must write the whole of the Torah, the whole Bible out by hand, twice. Now imagine that. You've got to go and write the whole Bible out twice, and you've got to put one Bible in your treasure box, and you've got to carry the other one you wrote with your own hand about with you wherever you go, reading it wherever you go. And he says that you might learn, watch this, to fear God. So, praise God, learning to fear God, doesn't come easy. God's showing us here it comes by the fact that you met you. Not only have you written your own Bible out by hand, we live in a day today that everything's easy. It's all done by printer. Amen. There's no hard work put into it. But not those days. They are to write it out by hand themselves. Amen. And carry it everywhere they go. Read it everywhere they go. Then you stand a chance of beginning to fear God. But we live in a day where people take it for granted that fearing God comes easy. It does not. It comes by treating the scripture, like it says in Deuteronomy 17, as, remember, the one's got to put in the treasure box as your treasure. One that you never let go of, that you take with you wherever you go and read it wherever you go. Amen. You're on the bus, you're on the tube, you're in the supermarket. Amen. People can see, amen, that you're listening to the Bible on your phone, you're reading your Bible on your phone. Whatever you do, wherever you go, that's the main objective. Then you'll learn to fear God. As brothers and sisters, if you're not doing that, don't fool yourself. The fear of God that you have will not be, going back to Exodus 24, verse 1, God said to Moses, go up to meet God. He said, Moses, where you are is maybe good, but it's not good enough. You need to go up. Amen. And that's how the scripture teaches us how to learn to fear God. Reading the Bible 10 minutes before you leave the house, and then that's it before you come back. You will not learn to fear God in the way, amen, that God wants you to. Amen. God will not be able to say to you, go up. Praise be to God, because you'll actually be going down. It's not enough to read the Bible 10 minutes a day. It's not enough. We need to have an attitude, amen, to want to do better if we want to go up. Praise be to God. Like Zacchaeus. Amen. When he knew Jesus was coming, he climbed the sycamore tree. What is that more? More about Jesus. More about Jesus. More of his saving love for me. More of his love who died for me. More sycamore about Jesus. More about Jesus. More of his saving love for me. Anyway, that's what Zacchaeus did. And he climbed the tree. Amen. And Jesus saw him. Why? Because he went up. And he proved that because he said to Jesus, I'm going to give so much of half of all that I have. Amen. To the poor. And if anything I've taken from people unjustly, I'll restore it fourfold. Wow, look at that. Praise be to God. Amen. Jesus says, salvation has come to your house this day, Zacchaeus. For I must come to you. Can you imagine Jesus saying that to you? I must bless you today. I must protect your children. I must heal your body. Because he sees an attitude inside of you, carrying the Torah with you wherever you go, reading it wherever you go. It's the treasure of your life. Praise be to God. Amen. Amen. You have a desire that you must go up. You want to go up. You want to do better. Then Jesus said to Zacchaeus, I must come to you. Amen. And you imagine Jesus having that attitude today that he must bless you. But that comes only, remember, with the attitude, Exodus 24, verse 1, go up. God said to Abraham, walk before me and be thou perfect. You're 100 now and you should be doing better. Amen. And that's the attitude that we must have, that we should be doing better. Praise be to God. Amen. And then, you know, when Moses went up, he was given the sacrifice, the animals, and half the blood that was in the basin, he poured it and put upon the people. Poured it over the covenant books and sprinkled it all over the people. Can you imagine that's Jesus when he sees you have the attitude to go up? Amen. Half the blood of Jesus is poured over you. You feel the blood of Jesus poured over you. Like he said, amen. Hey, that eats this blood and drinks, eats my flesh. Amen. Praise be to God. Amen. Those who don't have no part of me, for my amen. My flesh is meat indeed. Oh, praise be to God. Amen. And Jesus said, drink this cup that is given for the remission of sins. You just feel the remission of sins in your life as you go up. It will just be poured upon you. Amen. Hallelujah. You feel the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus upon your mind, on your thoughts, on your health, on your church, on your Bible reading, on your anointing. If you go up, and when Moses climbed up, it said he took the 74 elders with him. Amen. What does that mean? When you go up with God, you'll take people with you. Amen. When you went to church on Sunday, did you bring people with you? Can you imagine going into church with 74 people behind you? You'll do that when you go up. But if you're not going up, like we're talking about, you won't be bringing lots of people to church with you. Amen. You maybe just bring yourself up. But Moses climbed with 74 elders. And what does it say in Exodus 24? That they saw the God of Israel standing there. They saw Jesus standing there. Remember, it wouldn't be the Father, because they can't see the Father. No man has seen the Father. It was Jesus who they saw. Amen. Like Jesus walked in the garden with them. Like Jesus appeared to Abraham, as he said in the scriptures. It was Jesus they saw. Amen. Standing there. And they were surprised that the hand of God didn't strike them. Praise be to God, because Moses went up and he took people with him. We've got to stop pulling people down, and we've got to begin to pull people up. But we'll only do that if we have an attitude to go up. And Jesus just epitomized that, because remember in the Sermon on the Mount, the very first message he ever preached was in the Sermon on the Mount. Why? Because, amen, remember, and it says that when he was sent, then the disciples came unto him. He brought people with him. For Jesus was always beholding the Father. He was always, as Apostle Paul says, set your affections on things above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. And Jesus was always beholding the Father. The Father, looking down upon him, said, "This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased." Amen. And so he began his Sermon on the Mount. What a standard it was. Praise be to God. And he said, "You have heard it said." And here's what it means to go up. Thou shalt not commit adultery. But I'm going to bring you up now. I'm going to take you to a higher level. Even if you look at a woman and lust after, you've already committed adultery. Remember King David, soon as he looked at Bathsheba in the bath, that was it. He fell down until he went as low as you could go. Praise be to God, because he looked. Jesus was saying it's not enough, not just to commit adultery. Even looking at a woman lustfully, you've already done the act in your heart. You need to do better. He's bringing him up. He said, "You have heard that it is written, thou shalt not kill. But I say unto you, even if you're angry with your brother without cause, you've already in danger of the council." Praise be to God. So again, he's bringing them up. And that's what Jesus was doing, is bringing a teaching that was higher. Amen. Don't do your alms before men. Don't fast to be seen of men. Everything about him, amen, was bringing the people that came to listen to him up. Amen. When people come to you, do they get lifted up? Amen. To a different higher level, or do they stay the same? Is your church staying the same? Is your congregation staying the same? Is the anointing in your prayer meeting staying the same? Brothers and sisters, when you go up, amen, under the commandment of God to meet God, amen, to a different level, nothing stays the same. It will all change. The Bible says, for those who appear in Zion go from glory to glory. Amen. Praise be to God. And we see also the Apostle Paul. One of this is one of the most deepest teachings in the scripture. The Apostle Paul says this. And here's the perfect example, amen, of what it means to go up. The Apostle Paul says, "For I, Paul, count all things done for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ." You see? So there's the knowledge of Christ, the knowledge of these things. The knowledge of Christ is beautiful. That's what this is, preaching to you the word of knowledge that God has given me. That's the knowledge. And you can only have that when you know that things are done. God is not, the Holy Spirit won't move through me now like this, amen, if I don't class things as done. My brother, my wife, my children, the world, everything is done but for the excellency of Christ. As Jesus said, he that cannot forsake husband, wife, children for my name's sake is not worthy of me. The Holy Spirit has got to know that you know that all things are done but for the excellence of the knowledge. And that's when this knowledge comes forth. The Apostle Paul now takes us up to another level. And he says this in the next verse, Philippians, I think it's chapter 3. He says, but I now suffer the loss. Now it's different than counting all things but done for the excellence of the knowledge. He now goes one step further. But I now actually suffer the loss of all things. I counted them down before, but now I'll actually suffer the loss of all things that I might win Christ. What does that mean? Of course, he's already got Jesus. Win Christ is an anointing, meaning it's winning a deeper anointing of Christ, which the Apostle Paul says, for I have not yet apprehended, but I strive towards the higher calling. Amen. A higher portion of the anointing of Christ, which can only be given to you. Watch this. If you not just count things but done, you've got to go a step further. I actually suffer the loss of all things that I might win Christ. I don't have any aeroplane. I don't have any car. I don't have any house. Foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man have nowhere to lay his head. I don't have any money. Peter and John, silver and gold have I none. But such as I have, they're a higher calling. You see? Amen. The Christ that they won, I give unto thee in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. These things, saints, are only given to you if you go up and you suffer the loss of all things that you might win. People are wanting things from God without actually going up and actually counting things but done. And even more important, actually suffering the loss of all things that they win in Christ. And that's what the apostles were all about. Amen. And until we have that attitude and that mind, there will never be revival today. And you look at all the great revivals in the world today, and the Hazuna revivals and the Eaton Roberts revival in Wales. All these great revivals happened, but they all died. You know why? Because the suffering, the loss of all things that I might win Christ, amen, begin to deplete. And when that happens, we lose revival. The revival that God said was wanted to give Moses only if he went up, and he went up to Mount Sinai, not the valley, and it's there he received the commandments of God. It's there the commandments were written. You see, if we want the word of God written on our hearts, that means we absolutely do it without thinking. Then we've got to have an attitude to go. Ah, praise be to God. And that was what I got from Exodus chapter 24. When going on to Exodus 25, just briefly, you have a few statements, which is wonderful. God says to Moses, speak to the children of Israel, amen, that they may make a sanctuary for me, that I might dwell. And we know we have the Holy Spirit with us. We know that he's there. But sometimes he can grieve, and that's not what the scripture's saying here. What he's saying is that to dwell means to live comfortably with. Amen. To be at peace there. Remember the dove came upon Jesus and remained upon him. So John says, the Holy Spirit said, you will know who he is when the dove who descends and remains on him. That means dwells. Feels comfortable with, not grieved. Tell the children of Israel, amen, to make a sanctuary for me. And that's what we do by having an attitude to go up. All that we've said to you, amen, what you're showing God is you're making a sanctuary for him. What did God said to Moses said that Judah was my sanctuary and Israel was my domain. What does it mean? A place where God feels comfortable in. We all want the comforter to give us comfort. But can we allow, make a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit to dwell in, to feel comfortable in? Does God feel comfortable in us? Then you'll be comforted. We want so much comfort from the comforter. But are we comforting him? or are we grieving him? Amen. And only by going up, amen, will God see that we're truly making. I've not eaten today. I'm not telling you this to talk about my boast about fasting, because I'm nothing. I don't mean that. But I'm showing you by fasting and praying, what you do, you make a place for God to dwell in, to feel comfort in. That's what you're doing, praise be to God. Amen. Amen. A dwelling place, a place that God can call home, rather than a place that he comes and he's grieved. It's like I just bought some five rats for my little boy. Amen. A huge case, but it's a wonderful home. People say, why have you bought, it's like a 6-foot cage, why have you bought such a big cage for them? Because I want them to feel comfort. Remember, they're not in the wild roaming about. So now that I'm making a dwelling place for them, I want them to have plenty of place to roam about. And I make lots of toys and ladders and things for them to feel comfortable in. So when I put my hand in the cage, they run to me, they come on my hand, and they show me affection. They like my voice because they realize that I've made a place, a dwelling place for them, amen, to be happy in, amen. And that's what God is saying. Make a place for me that I'm happy in, amen, that he too might make you happy. Hallelujah. Beautiful scripture. And then God said to Moses, take for me an offering. Now, wow, what a word to use, take for me an offering. Why would God use that word? Isn't that beautiful? It's like when the God said, the Lord gives and the Lord takes. What God really means by that is that when you have made a dwelling place, a sanctuary for God to feel at home in, like safe and comfortable in, not rejected in, that gay man, God is able now to take. You know, when you love someone, you really love someone, and they come to your house, you know, and they stay with you, you say, help yourself. Go to the fridge, take what you want. Help yourself. Amen. I have some money here. Just take what you need. That's a sign that you truly love someone. Amen. And that's what God is saying, that when you truly go up and you show that you've made a dwelling place, a place that when I'm in you, I can hear the word of God always. I know you're always reading the scripture. God feels you're always praying. He's comfortable inside of you, dwelling in you. Amen. He's now going to feel like that person in your home, that he can come and take an offering. What a wonderful. But are we like that most times? That's what you feel from the church. Everybody's preaching about giving, giving, giving. Praise be to God. It's almost as if they're trying to persuade people, because people haven't got an attitude that God can just take. You know the sense when God truly has a sanctuary inside of you, a place where he feels comfortable, you won't need people to preach for you to give. The Holy Spirit will just come in and he'll take from you what he needs. Not even any tithes preaching. You wonder why the New Testament, there's not one scripture telling people that we should tithe. Amen. The tithing was something that was done under the commandment that was given to the tribe of Levi because they had no inheritance. Amen. Amen. Amongst Israel, because of Levi's sin, praise be to God, but the Shechem, Jacob custom, and said, you shall have no inheritance among your brothers. So that was given to them because they had no inheritance, no dwelling place, a commandment to be given to them. And Malachi, again, it was commandment, you have cursed this nation because you have robbed me in tithes. Also, they did not bring it to the Levites because they had no inheritance. But the New Testament, nothing. It's all about now the Holy Spirit coming and taking from you willingly what he wants. And you'll feel him. You won't need anybody to tell you. Holy Spirit will just move and just take from you. Why? Because you're willing. Why? Because you've made a sanctuary for him. A dwelling place. You've gone up higher. You've suffered the loss of all things that you might win Christ. Amen. Why? Showing God, you know, the value of what he has. Amen. Needs something inside of you. Like God said to Abraham, Abraham, amen, go and sacrifice your only son. Now I know that you fear me, that you value me above all things. Does God know you value him above everything in your life? And when he does, he'll just come and take. And then when it's like that, you know, here's the other side of the coin. God said to John in the Revelation, go to the angel and take. You'll be able to go to heaven and just take from God the things you need. Ask anything, believing you will receive. Why? Because you too will be able to go and just take from God the things you need. Because he too is able just to come and take from you. That's the fulfillment of what it means to go up. Praise be to God.